He has the best hand here on the turn, but Mello has a double gutter and a flush draw.
That's a pretty gross river.
In this kind of situation with an inflated pot, when you have the second nuts versus the nuts, it's gonna be difficult.
Hi guys, welcome back. I'm Christy. You are watching part two of a two-part poker vlog. So if you haven't watched part one, you definitely want to go back and watch that first. So last week I talked about a session in which everything went right.
5-7-7, Christy flop quads.
I ran good, played good, felt good, was on top of the world. I scheduled the very next week to play again, another 5-10 session with usually a $20 ante, $3,000 max. I was like, this is so easy. Let's play next week. And whenever you think that poker is easy, the poker gods will humble you. Because that's what happens, and that's what we're going to talk about today in part two of what happens when everything goes wrong. Ugh, this footage is like painful to watch, but I think it's important to look at it because we were all going to have disaster sessions. I want to show you guys what to look out for, what pitfalls may happen, and how to, in the future, avoid sessions that can go all the way down. And it's just real. This shit happens sometimes. It just like goes very poorly. So let's get into the footage, shall we?
And I'm looking forward to this particular one because my sister-in-law Christy is gonna be playing.
Nice, yeah, I played with Christy at the circuit final table here at the bike, I think 2 years ago. They're gonna be playing 5-10 tonight. I believe the max buy-in is 3,000.
All right, so as you can see, I'm rushing to get my chips. I would have been, like where the button is, I would have been dealt in the small blind. That's where I was sitting. So this very first hand that I play, I post in the cutoff. So it's just like the very next hand. I post in the cutoff, I get dealt ace, jack of hearts. So I'm like, oh, this is a good post hand. Then DJ Mello D, who is under the gun, but it's not really under the gun because there's a straddle. I think a player was missing, so he's like MP. He raises to 30 with queen, jack of spades. The player behind him named Marco calls with king, queen, O, and it folds to me again in the cutoff. I make it, I have three bets, and because of the glitching of the graphics, I'm not really sure what I made it. Both players call. The flop is 10 of hearts, 8 of spades, 7 of diamonds. When it checks to me, I could definitely c-bet, and I probably should with two overs, a straight draw, and a backdoor flush draw. I think that I was just feeling unsettled. I was like, oh, I'm gonna take a lower variant line, check back, you know, they won't put me on a lot of jacks when I check back if I hit a 9. I checked. The turn is the ace of spades, giving me top pair along with my gut shot straight draw. Once again, it checks to me. On the turn, I bet $230. DJ Mello's thinking, and he decides to put in a raise. Marco folds, and then the rest of my chips come in a rack. He raises to 630, which was 400 more for me to call. I'm in position. I think that he does this with a lot of combo draws. And also I have a draw to a straight myself. I still have top pair, which beats a lot of the combo draws like 9-10, 8-9. I think a set leads the turn. I also think that made hands raise bigger than just 400 more, maybe something more like 4x. Getting such a great price, I think I have the best hand a lot of the time, and also I have outs to a straight. I decide to call in position. Now the river is the offsuit 9. I'm thinking, great. This is so great. This is my card. Then he leads huge. He leads 1400. Now we only have another 800 behind. In these games, My general strategy is when I have a good hand, I'm going for value because I think that people play too loose and they call too much. And I was thinking, I only lose to Queen Jack, obviously. I think when I 3-bet, he doesn't have all of his offsuit Queen Jacks, so that's even fewer combos. So, but I shove and he obviously calls and I am reaching back into my purse after the very first hand. I think when he bets 1400, he either has a chop, a bluff, or Queen Jack. I'm obviously not getting called by a bluff, and I'm just chopping when he just has a jack, and obviously then I'm just losing an extra 800 when he has Queen Jack. So I think looking back, versus that huge size on the river, I think I should just call. So it's obviously really difficult to feel great about the session when you just get stacked immediately. And you can even see with my posture, I'm like slouching already a little bit, which is a mistake because your body helps inform your brain about how you feel. So sometimes you can change the position of your body, sit up more straight, and all of a sudden your brain will be like, oh, I'm confident, I'm breathing better. So it's like definitely a mistake to be slouching. So this very next hand, I'm freaking slouching, and under the gun plus one raises 290. I'm next to act with pocket sevens. I call 90. The flop is ace of clubs, jack of hearts, five of spades, and he c-bets, and I'm just gonna fold on this flop. Under the gun should be, you know, have a pretty tight range. Just think the best to just fold here. So a couple of hands later, Isabella raises to 40. I'm in the straddle with 9-7 off. When she just makes it double the big blind, I'm gonna peel here with pretty much any hand when there's dead money in the pot. The flop is 8 of clubs, 6 of clubs, 7 of hearts. Top pair, straight draw. It goes check, check on the flop. The turn is the 2 of hearts. And I decide to bet for value and protection, and I bet 65. She calls, and the river is the 3 of spades. I think I can probably bet here again. I think that's fine. But I decided to check, and she checks behind with ace 10 high, and we take down this very small pot. I was thinking maybe things could be turning around, but maybe not. So one round later, I'm in the straddle once again with 9-6 of clubs. Guido to my left limps under the gun and I check my option. The flop is 5 of diamonds, 8 of clubs, 2 of clubs. Checks to Guido and he bets 65. So when I'm in the straddle and I get to just check my option on this flop of 8-5 deuce, I have every single combo of 2 pair. All the offsuit combos, and that's a lot. So when I have a combo draw like this, I think it's best to play aggressively because I can rep so many good hands. He bets 65, I raise to 200, trying to get him to fold an 8-5, a deuce, ace highs, king highs, you know, his own straight draws, backdoor, whatevers, and he calls. The turn is the 3 of hearts, and I decide to go again. I bet 380. Now, from what I know about Guido is that he's a mood player. He plays pretty close to the vest, usually. He definitely has the capability of bluffing and playing loose, but you can usually tell that it's indicated by his mood. Now, this is early in the session, so I just believe that he's playing tight. So when he calls, I know that he likes to play trappy. That's like also his trappy game. And so when he calls flop and turn on a 5, I can rep less 2 pairs now. And I don't really have 8s because I would raise pre. So on this river, I'm just gonna give up. So it goes check, check, and he has pocket 10s. So that hand, I actually thought I played quite well, but not really winning a hand and kind of having a bluff go semi-wrong or at least not work out. It's starting to build up a little frustration in my insides. So then this hand comes up where the hijack limps and I'm in the cutoff with 9-10 suited. So I raise it to $50, folds around to the limper, and he calls. We're heads up. The flop is king of hearts, five of hearts, deuce of clubs. He checks and I bet small. This is a pretty dry flop. So I bet 55 and he pretty quickly check calls. Now he snap checks and the turn when the turn is an ace of spades. Now I'm just thinking to myself, I'm not thinking so much. That's the problem. The adrenaline has sort of been built up in my body, the cortisol, the frustration is going. Now, what I know, obviously, is that when he limp calls my raise pre, and the flop is king high, and the turn is an ace, this is such a great card for my range. Like, he's not limping ace king, and I have all the aces and kings and ace king, and I know I'm supposed to bet this turn. Suddenly, this thought of, I don't want to lose more money when I ain't got a hand, overtakes all of the logical thinking of range construction and advantage, and tilt comes in the form of a small mistake like checking this turn. Then the river is a six of hearts and he checks, and like now I'm like, I already checked the turn. A bluff doesn't really make sense. How many aces am I gonna check the turn? So then I just check back, lose to a deuce, and feel really dumb. You can begin to see how these things are compounding on one another. It's like, here we are, you can see the update. I'm stuck 3,600, almost 3,700. All right, next hand. I'm under the gun plus one with ace jack offsuit. I raise to 75. Guido, who is to my left in the hijack, calls. And seat four in the straddle calls as well. The flop is jack high, jack of clubs, six of hearts, four of diamonds, rainbow. I'm thinking, I'm about to win a hand. And I see bet 115. Flat calls are really working out for Guido calls, and the turn is the deuce of clubs. I think on this board, I think my hand is good enough for three streets, so I'm gonna bet the turn. The reason I think it's good enough for three streets is because, again, my strategy in these games when people call to lose preflop, call to lose post, is to just go for value. So on the turn, I bet 275 and Guido raises. He raises to 575, which was basically like a clickback. He raised me 300 more. When people do this, it's often like a feeler bet. Sometimes people do this with top pair, trying to set the price for showdown. They don't really do it with a draw, because obviously with a draw, they're bluffing and they want to at least give you the opportunity to fold. So when he makes it 300, I'm like, this is for a thin value, but I can beat a lot of thin value hands. Like sometimes people do this with like queen jack, again, trying to get to showdown for a price that they control. On the river is the queen of hearts. So I check and he bets 790. My instinct immediately is fold. But like, I flop top pair, top kicker. If I fold, I don't get to win this pot. So I thought about it. But again, at this point, a mood player, he was winning and just was not a place where he was gonna spaz. Rarely a bluff. And I folded. So at this point though, I didn't get to see his hand. And I'm just like, I just folded top pair, top kicker. This sucks. And I'm reaching back into my purse to get more money. But as you can see, it's interesting because as I'm sitting there, I'm thinking, oh, I just screwed up that hand with 9-10 suited. Maybe I just got bluffed. I'm looking bad on stream. All these things that don't really matter, but I'm not actually playing poorly other than like the check on the turn. And then check on the river, which I think is fine if I check the turn. So then this next hand comes up and I am in a straddle. The button raises to 75. The big blind calls 75. And I have queen jack suited in the big blind or the straddle, and I just call. I decided to just call pre, but if I knew how loose he was playing raising 7-5-0 on the button, I would have 3-bet for value. The flop is ace of spades, queen of spades, 10 of hearts. We all check to the button. He bets 175, the big blind folds, and I call. I call on the flop, obviously I have second pair, I have a gut shot, and I think this is a flop he would see bet a lot. Also, he bets small. So the turn is the jack of spades, so I check and he bets 400. Ugh. Obviously, like, he could have so many kings, he could have a flush, I have two pair. But I think my gut was starting to tell me, I think he's playing a little bit looser than I might know. But still, I think it's a fine fold, given all the hands that beat me. All right, I'm just gonna skip forward a couple hands because a couple of these are boring. They're just very small pots. Then this hand comes up where Marco raises in the cutoff, 275. I'm in the big blind with queen 10 of hearts. By this point, I've realized that Marco is loose. Very loose, and so I decide to 3-bet this hand. Also, because I'm in the big blind, you want to call us in the big blind when there's someone, another person in position in the straddle. You want to 3-bet a little more often. So I 3-bet to 275. Guido folds the straddle, and Marco calls in position. The flop is king jack nine rainbow. I flop the nuts. I'm like, oh shit. Things are turning around. You know, I finally have a hand. Woo! And since this is such a coordinated flop, and we're in a 3-bet pot, of course, I'm gonna bet. So I bet 300, and he folds. Do you know how I feel? I know you know how I feel, because it just happens in poker sometimes. That's just how sessions are sometimes. You're like, am I in the twilight zone? Does everybody just know? So on this hand, Big Al limps in the cutoff. The button makes it 90. And I'm in the small blind with ace king offsuit. So I 3-bet to 300. And the button pretty quickly calls. Now, by this point, we've all been playing together, and what I have learned about the button, Mr. Fabosh, in this hand, is that he's just very, very loose. And he's also been stacked once, at least, in this session. So when I flop top pair, top kicker on a king of hearts, queen of spades, eight of diamonds, I'm like, yes, finally have a hand. I think I can bet very small on this flop. He doesn't have a whole lot of chips behind.
Probably one third pot. And we don't know what Mr. Fabosh has here. He has only like half pot left. Christie's probably just going to put it in here. So it looks like Mr. Fabosh either has like a weak king, a queen, or maybe just jack 10 or something like that. Obviously, Christy has the best hand when he doesn't snap. But he may have got there. He did get there. Wow, jack 9. That's so sick for her. Only 4 outs. Christy just running so bad tonight.
And then I tap the table and say, good hand. Good, that's a good hand, and pay him the money. But inside, it's more like, you mother, not really, he's super nice, but Booga gods, motherfucker. At this point, I have no idea how tilted I am. I think that I'm in control. It's always hard to know exactly how you're feeling, but also, what was I gonna do? I'm playing on stream, I'm not gonna quit this session. So, this next hand comes up, Mr. Fabosh, who I just doubled up, limps. 20. I raise in the hijack with king jack O, knowing that, you know, he calls jack 9 O out of position. I raise to 100. Guido right behind me calls 100 in the cutoff, and Mr. Fabosh calls. The flop is ace of hearts, jack of diamonds, four of spades. Mr. Fabosh checks. I check, and Guido checks. I can definitely bet this flop. I have the range advantage, but I think with second pair top kicker, I think this is like, I don't have to protect against much. I just decide to check back. It's a medium strength hand. I'm out of position to one player. So the turn is the six of spades.
So with Guido checking back the flop, Christy thinks her jack is good. She has the best kicker, so she's going to go for a little bit of value. I think it's fine either way here. Guido's just going to call on Mr. Fabosh with a gut shot again.
Walk right in front of the whole thing going on. So, yeah, oh, sorry, guys.
Man, nothing really changes here on the river. Sure, Christy's going to be checking here after getting called by two players, and I think Guido has a pretty easy value bet, especially given that he underrepped his hand on the flop.
So he thinks for a bit, he cuts out some chips, and then he bets 565, which is rather large. So something that happens to me when I start to get tilted is when I get in spots where I can't really figure it out. I'm not really sure what to do. And there's a decent pot out there. Like, my emotions will override my thoughts with things like that tell me that I could do what I want to do, which is call. And the only reason why I want to call is because if I don't call, then I for sure lose. But if I call, then maybe he's bluffing and maybe I could win. I know it's terrible thinking, but it happens. And I can't even tell you what the reasoning I pulled from was. I think maybe like, oh, Guido doesn't check the flop. Like, what hands could he possibly have that he would check the flop and bet this big on the river unless he was bluffing? Something like that. And I called and get owned. So owned. I tanked for a long time and talked myself into calling. Look at me. Look at me go. So that was pretty much the worst hand I played by far. All right, and here are the stats. I lost almost 8K, almost exactly how much I won the week before. A little less, so I'm still up those two sessions, but that was a disaster. Actually, looking back, it's interesting because like I didn't, other than that hand where I called King Jack on the river, it wasn't like I played horribly, but it just feels like terrible. All the variants in a row. All right, that's it for this disaster session, one of my biggest losses to date. Something that my husband always reminds me of, because he is wise and a poker sage, that whenever you have both your biggest wins and your biggest losses, these are testaments to where you're going as a poker player. And they are rites of passages, because if you think about it, if you're constantly trying to improve, constantly moving up, playing bigger, you just will have your biggest wins and your biggest losses. So to try to not have them, or to worry about what it means when you do have them and make these big conclusions like, oh, you're actually just a terrible poker player, or whatever, it's like so different than thinking about it in the way that it's just part of being a poker player. All right, guys, I hope that was helpful for you guys to watch me get pummeled. I know that was super fun for me.